Now we understand a little bit about vector norms and matrix norms. And what I want to do is show how this can be used to gain some useful insight into the kinds of computations we're going to be doing in the rest of this course. And to do that, let's focus on solving A times X equals B. And let's just assume that A is a square matrix that is non-singular. In other words, it has an inverse. Now, you start with a right-hand sign B. That's the input. You solve AX equals B. That gives you an output vector X, the solution. What if you'd make a small change to B? For example, what if how you measured the right-hand side B wasn't all that accurate? So you know that there's a little bit error in it. Or what if you started with a vector, you stored it in a computer, Ramov error happens when you store it. A small error would occur. Obviously, what you would like is for there to be a small error in the solution as well. Small, well, we know how to measure small now. We use vector norms. But really, we are interested in relative error. We're really interested in the change in x relative to x that results when you do these two computations. And you want to compare that to the relative error in B. Now, let me take a time out and just point out. This is not delta times B. In other words, it's not a scalar times the vector B. I'm purposely trying to make the delta and the B touch to indicate that this is just a label for the vector that represents the change in the vector B. So let's try to keep track of that. Sometimes they may not quite touch, but hopefully you can stick with me. Now, what do we know? We know that A times X is equal to B. And we also know that A times X plus delta X is equal to B plus delta B. All right? We know that matrix vector multiplication distributes. So we can replace this by A times X plus A times delta X. Right? And then we can take the first equation, subtract it off the second equation, and say, oh, that leaves us with A times delta X is equal to delta B. So there's this nice relationship between the error that was introduced and the error in the solution. All right. Now, we want to start taking some norms. And to do that, we start with this, and we rewrite it as B is equal to A times X, so that we can take the norm on both sides. And then if we used an induced matrix norm, then we know that this is less than or equal to the norm of A times the norm of X. All right. We can actually rearrange this to get something that looks like it might help us here by saying, let's bring the norm of X to the left, the norm of B to the right, and rewrite this as 1 over the norm of X is less than or equal to the norm of A times 1 over the norm of B. That puts us partially towards this right here. All right. Now we need to somehow relate delta X and delta B, the norms. And for that, we're actually going to rewrite A times delta X is equal to delta B as delta X is equal to A inverse times delta B. We can do that because we assumed that A was non-singular, and therefore we know it has an inverse matrix. Then we can take the norm of that, and we can bound that by the norm of A inverse times the norm of delta B. All right? Now, multiply this times this on the left and this times this on the right, we get one, we get delta x over x, well, the norm of delta x over x, the relative error in x, is bounded by the norm of A times the norm of A inverse times delta B, the relative error in B. Right? So, we now have answered our question. The small error in B can be amplified no more than this quantity right here, which we call the condition number of matrix A. Obviously, this condition number depends on which norm you chose. Now, when we talked about induced matrix norms, we saw that there is a vector x such that the norm of A times x is equal to the norm of A times the norm of x. And we saw, similarly, that there is a choice for delta B such that A inverse times delta B in norm is equal to the norm of A inverse times the norm of delta B. All right? What does that mean? That means that this is a tight bound. This means that there are choices for delta B and B such that the relative error is actually amplified exactly by the condition number of A into the relative error in X. So, this is not a pessimistic view. This is something that could happen. Later in the course, you're going to find out that the condition number of A depends on how close A is to being singular. So, all of these things will start falling in place as we move on through the course. Now, in the notes, we sharpen all of this. Okay? We develop the notation a little bit better. We dot all the I's. You will do a few exercises that will help you along, and then you'll hopefully understand everything regarding this topic.